The opinions expressed by individuals and guests do not necessarily reflect those of WRGN Rain Radio ATL or Sound Feast Media LLC. And I don't know if you'll ever hear me, but I got salt in my wounds from the tears that resulted. Every hurt shows we're mortal. And
hey, what's up now?
Brother, what's up?
This is a deep recording, man.
Welcome to the Word on the Streets with JP. I'm your host, JP, and you're not going to want to miss today's Sound Feast in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
You can't stop. Can't stop, won't stop. Where the brakes at? I give him that ditty bop. Like, take that, take that, take that.
Welcome to another episode of Word on the Street with JP. I'm your host, JP, and as always, I'd like to thank you for checking this teaching out with me today. Today is May the 26th, 2021, and the question I have for you is, are we in the eye of the storm, or has the storm passed? That's the questions. It sure is quiet, and that's alarming to me. So what I know is that this Christian walk is a bit like a large body of water. It seems so quiet and calm on the surface, but beneath there are a whole lot of things happening. There's the wildlife that inhabit the body of water, exercising the laws of nature, and there is the current that is strong enough to defeat the most accomplished of swimmers. This is why wise swimmers, even though they are experienced, always enter with safety gear. As a Christian, we must always have our safety gear at hand. In saying that, this show is going to point out whether you are a safety-minded swimmer or one that is haphazardly wading in the water, not taking in consideration of what the consequences could be. You ask, what is our safety equipment? What's in our safety equipment bag? I'm glad you asked. The first thing and the most important thing that we must have is knowledge. The knowledge that will assist in our survival and will help us not only to see, but to fight against whatever is being thrown at us. This is the foundation that ensures our success, and it begins by us knowing who we are in Christ. A lifeguard at the local YMCA, he has to have a certification before he can assist a failing swimmer. So we as Christians, we have to have the knowledge that will help us to be successful in whatever we're doing. This is the foundation that ensures our success, and it begins with us knowing who we are in Christ. So in Matthew, the 5th chapter, the 13th verse, it says, "Ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt have lost his savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out, and to be trodden under foot of men." So it's saying, man, we're supposed to be flavor in a flavorless world. And if we're not going to be the flavor, who will be? If we call ourselves Christians, but we don't act according to what God has called us to do, then what good are we? Good enough to be thrown away and trampled underfoot. That's what the Word of God says. The question is our life evident of Matthew 5:13? If it is, then Matthew 5:10 through 15 is who we are. These passages of Scripture not only tells us what the powers we should be equipped with, but also tells us what the reward will be for exercising our Christian love skills, which are counted as blessings by God. Matthew, the 5th chapter, the 10th through the 16th verse, starts at verse 10 saying, "Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Verse 11 says, "Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you for my sake." Verse 12, it says, "Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you." Verse 13 says, "Ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt has lost his savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and to be trodden underfoot of men. Verse 14, ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. Verse 15, neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it gives light unto all that are in the house. Verse 16, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. If we do all these things, we are in the will of God. The world will count these love skills as foolish, and we will be persecuted for righteousness' sake. You can count on it. Men shall revile you. You can count on it. You'll be persecuted if you stand on the truth. You can count on it. And they shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. And they'll see things like, oh, he's tripping. Oh, he's too intense. Oh, it don't take all that. But, oh, yeah, it does according to God. Verse 16 tells us to continue in the faith so that God may be glorified. So don't let people talk you out of your equipment. John, the first chapter, the 12th verse, says, yet all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. So this is who we are in God. Like those lifeguards and like those EMS people, they know who they are and they know by what qualifications they come to do their tasks. And so shall we be as Christians. Let me read John, the first chapter, the 12th verse again, as I have many verses to remind us of who God has called us to be. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Romans, the 8th chapter, the 28th verse says, and we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. John, the 15th chapter, the 16th verse says, you did not choose me, I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. Genesis, the first chapter, the 27th verse says, so God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. So don't get it twisted. If you're born a male, baby pop, you a male. Sugar dumpling, if you born a she, that's who you are. Don't get it twisted and try to change, switch around God's order of things. It's not going to work for you. Jeremiah, the first chapter, the 5th verse says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. 1 Peter, the 2nd chapter, the 9th verse says, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of the darkness into his marvelous light. John, the 15th chapter, the 15th verse says, I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friend, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. Philippians, the 3rd chapter, the 20th verse says, but our citizenship is in heaven, and we early await from there the Lord Jesus Christ. Romans, the 8th chapter, the 37th verse says, no, in all things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. So now let's go back and take a look at who God has made us to be in detail. He says that we are set apart and appointed as prophets to the nations. Wow. We've been appointed by him to go and spread the gospel to the nations. He also says that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose, chosen and appointed to bear fruit and qualified to get whatever they ask of God the Father. He says that we are no longer called servants or considered servants to him. We are called to know our master's business. That makes us God's friend. and that's where we want to be. He also calls us citizens of heaven, and that we win every battle that we engage in because he loves us. These things describe our identity in Christ. So why won't we boldly act, believing in what God has made us to be? Now, I know that I teach messages that are pretty much in your face on this show, and I don't pretend to be perfect, as I have personal battles that I address and fight daily. I'm not sure how many people actually watch this podcast, but just know that I teach only what I'm led to teach, and most of the time, I end up teaching me. Sometimes the message stings me as much as I know it stings some of you. And that's why we've got to get it together. If we're getting stung, then we need to adjust so those sorts of feelings and emotions and guilt don't happen to rise up again. I have to constantly remind myself that Jesus has already defeated the enemy. Having said that, I know that life has been pretty challenging for the masses around the world, and some haven't survived, and some can't hang on much longer. The world is in a tailspin and is in desperate need of help. The help that can only be found in Jesus. For the believers of Jesus Christ, life has been especially hard as we are careful lately to pick our battles. Some we will win and some we will lose. And that is absolutely not the right way to approach the problems that we face. The Word of God says that we are more than conquerors. Not just conquerors, but more than conquerors. That doesn't mean that we win sometimes. It means that whenever we step out onto the field, we win 100% of the time. Sometimes it doesn't feel or look like you won, but standing on faith will manifest that victory that you prayed for and believed for when you first stepped foot in the conflict. It's time for us to truly believe that. We are called to fight as Christian soldiers, but some are sitting on the battlefield sidelines, letting atrocities occur. And these are battles that we've been empowered to win, but we can't win if we don't get into the fight. So again, my question is, where is the church? Where is our battle cry for Christ and for truth? Where are the individual victories that should manifest for the glory of God? I believe the reason we stand in silence is because we are being divided and shamed for our faith. So we ask ourselves, as we stand alone, what difference could I possibly make? You can make a big difference. Standing on the truth, studying the Word of God, and much prayer, that's where the answer is. That's where the answer lies. The answer to that question. Don't you know that we are empowered to obtain those victories that the world so desperately needs? Don't we know that through Christ, we are the answer to people's prayers? Don't we realize that the Spirit of Jesus lives in us and gives us all we need in order to win every single battle? It's time to take our faith in Christ seriously, as the end of all things, as we know it, is drawing near. So, body of Christ, put on your grown-up undies and get into the fight. If you don't know where the fight is, take a look at the world and the events that are occurring therein and begin to ask God where he needs you on the battlefield. Do you take up the rear so we don't get flanked by the enemy? Is your assignment to act as a scout so we can inform our troops of impending danger on the trail? Are we foot soldiers ready for close quarter conflict or hand-to-hand combat? Or do we man the communications in prayer in order to get instructions on how to win? Because while we sit by afraid to make a mistake or a decision, folks are dying without hope. We must realize that they are counting on our involvement in the fight, our victory. So the saddest thing that could happen is that we allow those who need the God in us to fall by the wayside because we hesitated. Don't be trigger happy, but at the same time, don't be afraid to act by standing up for what is right. And if you get into trouble, I assure you that your rescue is dependent on your faith in God and what he has called you to be and to do. Even though you can't see the rescue chopper coming, it doesn't mean that it's not on the way. Trust in the Lord and you'll experience that what I'm saying to you is true. Well, that's all the time we have for today. Sure hope that you enjoyed the teaching. It was short, but right in your face, we need to be constantly reminded who we are to God and the power that He has endowed us with in order to thwart every attempt of the enemy. You don't have to be a rocket scientist. You don't have to have your finger on the pulse of world events. You don't have to have inside stories on things that are happening, but all you need is the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, who will lead you and guide you in all truth and understanding. He will wake you up in the middle of the night to pray for something that you don't even know is taking place. And when you finally find out what happened overnight, then you'll understand exactly what I'm talking about. He will give charge to His angels to protect you in all you do, if you acknowledge Him in all your ways. Then on that path, everything you need will be provided. So if you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior, please, please, please make a decision to choose Christ today. So my question to you is, if you were to die right now, would your destination, according to your acts and your faith, be heaven or would it be hell? I pray that you make the right decision. The Bible says, choose life. And this is your opportunity. So again, if you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior, please repeat this simple prayer after me. Lord God, we just praise You for giving us this time of fellowship that we might be strengthened by the reminder of who You have called us to be. We recognize that You are the one and only true and living God, Jehovah, and that You sent Your only Son, Your most beloved Son, Jesus, into this world to relieve us of our sin debt by dying on the cross at Calvary. I know that I'm a sinner, and so I humbly ask Jesus into my heart that He would be my God and I would be counted among the redeemed, ready to serve You by serving others. In Jesus' holy name, the name above every name, we pray. Amen. So if you said that simple prayer, I believe that you just became born again. So welcome to the family of faith. My first recommendation to you is for you to ask God where to find a Bible-based ministry where you can have holy fellowship with other believers and grow in the things of God. Thank you so much for listening and watching Word on the Street with JP. I'm your host, JP. And if you liked what you heard or saw, please visit my YouTube channel, which is Rain Radio ATL. That's R-E-I-G-N, Rain Radio ATL. And just look for Word on the Street with JP. Make sure that when you find it, subscribe, like, and definitely share, as our mission here is to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ to all corners of the world. Or if you could also friend me personally on Facebook. I've got 5,000 friends, but you know, people fall off because they get offended. So once you take one of their places and friend me, I'll make sure that I add you into my friend corral. You can also find Word on the Street with JP at www.108praiseradio.com. Or catch Word on the Street on Instagram, and you can follow me there at j.parker.radio. So thank you so much for your time today, and I pray that you would be blessed to be a blessing to someone else. And until next time, I love you, and that's right, we'll see you on the radio.